Larry, you have the control. Larry, you're muted.
Hello?
There you are, Larry.
Oh, great. Jamai, everyone. A warm Yupik greeting to everyone. Thank you and welcome for joining us today for the webinar on Ikaiyurtet, those who help. The topic for this webinar is on domestic violence, an unfortunate reality that impacts our loved ones. A short background on ANA. ANA strives to promote self-sufficiency for Native Americans by providing discretionary grant funding for community-based projects, free training and technical assistance to eligible tribes and Native organizations. There are currently 6 grant programs under ANA available to Native American community-driven projects. ANA's vision is that Native communities are thriving. I'm trying to advance to the next one, Charles. Okay, thank you. Today you will be hearing from 2 programs in Alaska. This webinar will showcase a rural shelter and a statewide advocacy program in Alaska that respond to and provide support and advocacy for Alaska Native and American Indian women, children, and people. A board member from the Safe Shelter in Dillingham, Alaska, created this beautiful image, Imakhpik Inc. Amber Webb, a Chukun tribal member, who's also Yupik, Sukhpek, and Unangan from Dillingham, Alaska. After creating it, she said, "This is a wood and ink prayer for everyone, especially every Native woman who is not safe at home or who has no home in which to seek refuge. During this time of crisis global tension, there will be people who are separated from their support networks and the services needed to protect themselves. If you are one of those people, know that there are millions of us who stand with you and pray for your safety. May your ancestors surround you and watch over you. May you find a way to be as safe as possible." Amber has also created a large women's kasbuk that had some of the faces of murdered and missing Indigenous women in Alaska that heightened the awareness of MMIEW and mobilized our communities into action, including Alaska's legislation. I want to thank Amber and acknowledge her for allowing us to share this image. And I believe she's attending this webinar. So, Uyana Jaknak, Amber. There are 4 regional centers that work with ANA to provide support through trainings and technical assistance to tribes and tribal organizations. The Pacific region serves Hawaii and the Pacific Island territories. The Western region serves states from the Pacific coast up to Montana, down to New Mexico. Eastern region covers the states from the Dakotas to Texas to the Atlantic coast. Alaska region serves the entire state of Alaska. Sister Sky assists our language programs that are funded. Today's webinar is hosted by the Alaska Region's Training and Technical Assistance Center, one of the 4 regional TTA centers that support ANA. My name is Larry Gayrayok. I am Yupik and an enrolled member of the Village of Shifornik. I am the Technical Assistance Manager for the Alaska Region. We're glad that you could join us today to learn from this, what a rural and or local and statewide agency group is providing to women, children, people who experience domestic violence. ANA's Training and Technical Assistance Centers offers free training, technical assistance, webinars, and useful tools and guides to assist you in preparing applications to ANA. Today's webinar's goals are that attendees will hear from service providers to have a deeper understanding of the issue, and participants will gain knowledge of resources that are available for existing and new programs. And speaking of resources, here are a few national resources available for those who work in this field and those who may need help. They are the Department of Justice, Tribal Justice and Safety, Office of Violence Against Women, and the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Family Violence and Prevention Services Act. And all of their web links are provided up there. Okay, we have strong, incredible, and caring frontline workers who give their time, energy, and hard work and love to individuals who experience violence and trauma in their lives. I would like to introduce our guest speakers, Marilyn Castile, an Aleut from the Bristol Bay region. She is the executive director that oversees the Safe Shelter in Dillingham, Alaska, which provides support for 25 surrounding villages, including the city of Dillingham. And Janelle Chapin, an Athabascan from Caltech in Illinois. She is a program specialist for the Alaska Native Women's Resource Center, a program that advocates for Alaska Native and American Indian women at the statewide level. Through this webinar and the two Alaskan programs sharing what they do, we hope that you will take away some new ideas and renewed energy to help your local programs. We are honored to have these two Alaska Native women warriors to share their experiences in this field. Welcome, Marilyn and Janelle, and I will turn it over to Marilyn.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Guyana Chaknak Larry for that kind introduction. There's a couple acknowledgments that I'd like to do before we start. Amber Webb's picture there is most beautiful, and that's actually the first time I've seen that, so thank you for sharing that. And I'd like to acknowledge those who suffer from domestic violence and sexual assault. I'd like to also acknowledge our survivors and those have been lost and murdered from domestic violence and sexual assault. Today, I'll be talking about state programs as a service provider, and meaning our main funding source comes from the state of Alaska, from the Council on Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault. And we have 23 members with the Alaska Network and Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault programs around the state of Alaska. And we provide safe, confidential services, and SAFE is one of those members. Oop. Oh, SAFE story. Safe and fear-free environment. We're located in Dillingham, and we are Bristol Bay Shelter Prevention and Advocacy Agency for Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault Victims. Dillingham has a population of about 2,400 people and is a hub for dozens of surrounding villages in Bristol Bay, and SAFE has a service area about the size of Ohio, but yet only about 7,000 to 9,000 people in the whole area. So we're pretty isolated here. We are a nonprofit which has been the primary provider for domestic violence and sexual assault prevention and assistance services in the Bristol Bay region since 1981. And I just want to plug in that I received services from SAFE in about 1983. It was just a little tiny house with no shelter. And it sat kind of in the middle of town. I could remember being embarrassed to walk into that building when I first went in, but the help they gave me, you know, kind of grounded who I am today. So I appreciate that, but I still have my times, and the really cool thing about my work here is this picture, and what you're seeing here is what I see when I look out of my window. And when I'm having a bad day, all I have to do is look across a tundra, and my home where I live is straight across from safe. So that's my safety net. You know, when I'm here, it's safe. Very beautiful. We're all brown, and today is a totally different day. It's cloudy and rainy and really brown. So, okay, about SAFE. SAFE is in Dillingham. As I mentioned before, we have 2,400 people, and we're the size of Ohio. Dillingham has very few roads. We have a road to Aleknagik, which is 24 miles away, and there are no other longer roads. Most of the villages that we travel to, we have to fly to, but we do it. The nearest city is Anchorage, and we can't drive there. It's 315 roadless miles northwest of Dillingham. Alaska Airlines comes here, and also several smaller aircraft provide transportation between Anchorage and Dillingham, and a variety of planes provide planes between Dillingham and the villages here. Our community of Dillingham is rich with ancient heritage and surrounded by the beauty and abundance of the Alaskan wilderness. Our community is ancient, and we have a rich heritage where we're diverse in our cultures and in our peoples. We have about 16% Alaska Natives here, but yet 23% of Alaska Natives are victimized. Our community is largely Yupik, Eskimo, and Aleut. And those are, the north is Eskimo, the south is Aleut, and the east is Athabascan. And this is going the wrong way. And I'm on my map and I can't get there. There you go. There's Bristol Bay. And Bristol Bay is in southwest Alaska. Advocacy in rural Alaska. So why would we want to work in a women's shelter? You know, and the reasons many of us at this shelter anyway, why we work here, because we're survivors of domestic violence and sexual assaults ourselves. So we feel like we understand what our women are going through. And not only that, but when we see their faces, when they come into their shelter, and how heartbroken they are with their children, that really keeps us going. We keep our focus on those individuals that really, really need our help. Working here, you see and hear things you never seen before. We work in such a personal arena of personal lives that we have heard things from our clients that no other people have. We have to keep those very secret, because confidentiality is a big thing in our business. So, and then we also have a handful of women that were lost here in Bristol Bay. Those women, That's who we're working for. We have fire in the belly to do this work every day. We have to have that fire in the belly. Otherwise, we might get into a situation of vicarious trauma, and that could be even worse. But the main thing, we are survivors. We are trauma-informed. When we are trauma-informed, we're able to talk to a client and kind of gauge where they're at and provide them the services that they have on their level. We understand what others are going through because we've been there ourselves. You know, and safety is the number one goal. You know, if we didn't have everything locked up, everything chained up around here, you know, it just wouldn't be safe. Another thing is confidentiality, and it all goes back to the safety, because if we didn't have confidentiality, people would know who'd be living here, and sometimes the perpetrators don't act too keenly with that. The biggest thing, we value our own experience. As I said before, we see and hear things that we have never seen before. As advocates, we are a network of caring, compassionate individuals. And as advocates, we make sure we have a system of self-esteem built by patient kindness, lecturing, and we make sure that we celebrate our successes, because sometimes we're long and few between. Our life experience and personal story show our clients' teachings they learn to become a strong, healthy person. So if you look at the picture on the right, the collage, this is, we had Jeremy Braithwaite do a presentation on sexual assault in rural Alaska. And he took all of these words from all of the women's voices who he talked to. So this is like domestic violence and sexual assault. It's really not one word, but it impacts our whole life in every way. Missing, murdered, and Indigenous women. So I heard on the radio this morning that Florence Akpilak from Nome, Alaska has been actively missing now for 34 days. And Diane Miller, I took a quote from her. She says she has lost a sister and a brother to homicide, stating that we are losing too many beautiful Native people, Native women. It hurts. It's tragic. It hurts families and children, their children, not to come home. I know the feeling. Us Alaska Native people make up about 16% of the state's population. And I mentioned 23% earlier, but that was wrong, and I apologize. But it accounts for 29% of the homicide victims here in Alaska. And it's sad, because we're in this business, but we are human first. And our families, mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, aunties, uncles, grandparents, friends, they all matter. So why us? I know I do this work because I'm a survivor of domestic violence and sexual assault. And I am an alcoholic in sobriety for over 30 years. And I do this work because I do not want to have to suffer, anyone to suffer as I did. I kept it all to myself, you know, because right now I'm a 63-year-old woman. And when I was going through this, it was a time of you made your bed, you sleep in it. So, you know, I learned to take it into my heart and keep it there. And it kept there for many, many years, over 30 years, and I'm finally letting pieces of it out. And I realize there's one piece that I need to do yet, and that's forgiving my abuser, which I have not done yet. And I'm still waiting for the right time and place to do that. So when I see the people's faces and hear their stories, it brings me back to where I once was. And that inspires me to get more involved. The fire in my belly is a flame of hope that I will never put out, even though that flame is barely a flicker. So feeding our souls. I don't think I would have ever gone past, you know, sobriety and all the things that I have done to feel like a human if I didn't have the resilience that my parents gave me as a child growing up. Yeah, and because of that, I was able to love and forgive almost everybody that has hurt me. But a big thing is taking care of our own selves, you know, wellness. Knowing our historical trauma, that's a big piece. And when we went through Jeremy Braithwaite's presentation, you know, Bristol Bay's historical trauma, according to the women that he interviewed, you know, they talked more on the Bristol Bay salmon permits, the ANWR, and more things, not so way back and historical, but everything was moved up like 20 or 30 years. So that was quite interesting to me. We got to know our own personal support system and practice what we preach. And the protective factors, we have them. And once all of those are met, we will have a strong community, strong families, successful children. And I cannot wait for that day. I might not be here, but my grandchildren may see it, because I have broken that cycle of violence. I have broken that cycle of sexual assault. I have broken that cycle of alcoholism. So Koyana Chaknak, thank you very much.
Thank you, Marilyn. And thank you for sharing your story as well. So we will turn it over to Janelle.
Good morning. Thank you, Marilyn. Thank you, Larry. So I work for Alaska Native Women's Resource Center. We are a nonprofit we are located in Fairbanks, but we serve the entire state. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what we do and impacts on victims and survivors in our villages. So the Alaska Native Women's Resource Center is dedicated to strengthening local tribal governments' responses through community organizing efforts, advocating for the safety of women and children in their communities' homes, and especially against domestic violence, sexual abuse. We believe that our tribes have the answers to protecting our women and children. And sometimes they may need a different set of tools to help them organize, and that's where we come in. We only go into communities that we are invited into, and we always meet tribes where they're at, and we try to bring the best set of skills that may be able to help them create their safety responses. So what do? We have several different kinds of technical assistance, but the most important thing is that we do it through an Indigenous Alaska Native view-based system. So we have a curriculum project where we talk about different types of violences, how it affects our villages, how we hold our abusers accountable, and how we support our victims and survivors. And it's all done through the community eyes. Right now we're doing a set of webinar series in the Southeast because all of our services are having to be virtual right now because of COVID. But typically we go anywhere from 9 to 12 villages a year with services. And when we do our curriculum engagements, typically they are regional with up to 4 to 5 villages. Each year we do a unity meeting, and that is going to be happening next week. So if you're interested in that, please visit our website. We also participate in policy advocacy at the national level. And one way we do that is through the NCIA task force and participating in Alaska Tribal Caucus. So if you visit our website, you can see different ways to engage with us. My email is also included on here. You can reach out to me if your community is interested. And now I'm going to move on and talk a little bit about different types of violences. So typically when we talk about domestic violence, we're accustomed to talking about physical abuse, but there are many other forms. There's verbal, emotional, financial, and sexual abuse. And when we do any type of those abuses, we're also impacting spiritual and emotional abuse every time. So it's a, excuse me, let me grab a drink of water. It's controlling or threatening violence against a spouse, partner, or family member. And we realize that in our communities, our family systems are very different, and so they are not traditional. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that as we move through where that breakdown in our families came in and how that's impacting us today. So you can see in here, I left in the Tlingit and Haida piece because that's where this was taken from. So none of our languages have any words for domestic violence because it didn't traditionally exist in any of our communities and our cultures. It's a new social problem that we've been fighting for the last several generations. It was introduced with colonization, and it was acts of war against our tribes because we know that our women are sacred in our communities and they're the heart of what we do. When we defeat our women, that's when people were able to come over and take it over our communities. Traditionally, our cultures were all one of respect. And if there was violence in a family, it was handled immediately, and depending on where you were from and how that was handled. But traditionally, it was elders speaking to that person. And there was real threats of banishment if the violence continued. Violence was never acceptable in our communities. And today we have our levels of violence are at epidemic rates, as well as our missing and murdered women. So we also do work around that as well. If you watch our Facebook, you'll see events that we do in May. For example, last May we did, because of COVID and not being able to do a march, we did a Facebook campaign where we talked about a different statistic or brought awareness to a different thing for MMIW each day in May. So domestic violence is always about power and control, and it's a pattern of abuse. It's meant to control or hurt another person. It's very common in our victims and our communities. And unfortunately, we all know people and love people who are both a victim and a perpetrator. And so our goal is that our communities find a way to be able to integrate our abusers back safely into our communities. We do realize that not everyone is going to be able to be safely in their community, depending on the circumstances, but we believe that our people, for the most part, want the violence to stop. And so we have to find an integrated way to not only help our victims, but begin to help our abusers. So one part that I think is really important that we're starting to talk more about as we move through this work is spiritual abuse. And some examples of that are minimizing our demeaning someone's culture or religion, forcing or denying access to it, or it can be connected to sexual abuse as well, such as denying birth control, forcing multiple pregnancies upon someone, purposely becoming pregnant without talking to your partner. Those are all different forms of not only sexual abuse, but spiritual abuse if it's used in the context of a religion. So spiritual abuse was the main tool used during colonization. It was used to take apart and dismantle our family systems and our spiritual beliefs that held us strong for centuries before. So I want to read this because it just has such a deep impact on the roots of all the violence in our state against our people. So this was the U.S. citizenship requirement for Alaska when we became a territory. So not when we became an actual state, but prior to that. We, the undersigned, declare that we have given up our old tribal relationships, that we recognize no chief or clan or tribal family, that we are given up all claims to or interest in tribal and communal houses, that we live in one family house in accordance with the customs of civilization, that we observe the marriage laws of the United States, that our children take the name of the father and belong equally to father and mother, and that the rights of the maternal uncle to direct the children are no longer recognized, and that in the case of death of either parent, we recognize the laws of the United States relevant to inheritance of property, and that we have discarded the totem and recognize the stars and stripes as our only emblem, and that we are self-supporting and law-abiding people. So every time I read that, it just hits me. It's the disintegration of our families as a whole, of our tribal and clan and family systems at the very basis. It even says in there that if we lived in communal homes, that it was uncivilized. And we know that our families lived in communal homes for support and that each family member had an important role. So this was the beginning of the degradation of our cultures and our people. And it just has such an impact. I almost cry every time I read it because it's just so visible what has happened to our people in this statement alone. So when we talk about relationships and healthy families, we talk about trust in each other. And so how do we begin to install these back into our community? We know we have great examples of healthy relationships in our community. And so beginning to highlight them and teach these and no longer accept violence in our communities. And it's not always easy when we're living in them, we know that. So we begin to model those and hold up those healthy relationships and teaching trust and respect of each other. We feel equal with our partner and share responsibilities. We have open and fair, honest conversations. We feel safe to share our thoughts and ideas when we're in a healthy relationship. We always have the right to say no to anything. So saying no is a right that you also have if you are in an abusive relationship, but we know when we're in an abusive relationship, we're not always heard. And so sometimes that can be a really hard one for people to understand, that even if you are in a long-term relationship, a short-term relationship with someone, you always have the right to say no. And when you're in a healthy relationship, you know that's going to be heard. And then we also understand that sometimes even healthy relationships don't work out. So what are some of the things that we can do if someone we know is experiencing domestic violence? First of all, not staying quiet. Get help, speak up, and don't stay silent. And so some of our communities, that may look different. Sometimes it may be calling law enforcement, but we also realize that our communities don't have great access to law enforcement in all communities. So sometimes it's just having a conversation when it's safe for that woman to talk. Talking about a safety plan of what it may look like our women know best how to keep themselves safe when they're in these relationships that are violent, And so they are the authorities on how to keep themselves safe. And so listening to them and finding out what's going to help them is going to be important. One thing that we need to really emphasize in our communities and begin to talk about is that no matter what is happening, it's never the victim's fault. I think unintentionally we may question why they stay. Why do you continue to let this happen? And so moving forward, what that looks like. Talking to them about, so reaching out and getting them family and friends support. Finding out what services your tribe may offer. Many tribes now have a lot of grants available to help. So when I talked about we're a TA provider, what that means is we offer technical assistance for the Office Against Violence Against Women grants, the Family Service Prevention Act grant, and also the Victims of Crime grant. And in 2019 was the first time that our tribes had access to the Victims of Crime grants. And we are really looking forward as programs are implementing this year, how it's changing our communities and keeping our people safe. Because traditionally you had to have a case report number from a law enforcement officer to be able to access Victims of Crime. Well, now that our tribes have access to that money, and many have applied throughout the state, they can implement their own victims programs. And so they can define what a victim looks like. So in a traditional US court, you might have to be a victim within, like, say, a year to be able to give Victims of Crime services. Our tribes can now say, you may have been victimized when you're 5 years old, and that's what's led to this path of destruction that you're on, and we need to get you some skills and some help to be able to help you where you're at today. And so the Victims of Crime money opened that doors for us. So that's one way that we can help our women and children when they're coming to ask for help, finding out what our tribe has that may help them. So if your tribe is lucky enough to have village police officers or access to state troopers, we know that our state troopers are greatly understaffed and that the response may not be as fast as we would like. And so our communities all have some type of safety net in place. It may not be one that is officially, like, written down, but we know that we had ways to keep our women and children safe. And so when we begin to look at that and we look at what's around us, we can watch the homes that children go to when they, that they're gravitating towards when they need support and that type of thing. And so we can begin to look at our community plans. And that's part of what our engagement process does, is look at our community, looking at the skills that our community already has in place to strengthen our response. We can talk to our health aides about what they may be able to do to help. And we may begin to make safety plans with someone. So we know that when someone begins to leave, that that's the most dangerous time for them. And so we want to talk about that before they just pick up and leave, because the threats of lethality can increase as well as harm to others around us. And so some of the things that we may want to talk about is preparing a go bag with important papers, social security cards, change of clothes, any medicines that they may need, enough to keep herself and her children safe for 2 or 3 days. If you're able to store any extra cash, that type of thing, and where you might keep that go bag. And where you might stay if you are to leave. So we know that it's not easy to just get out of our communities, especially since COVID hit and we've lost access to multiple different airlines in different regions of our state. Some of our villages aren't getting service more than once or twice a week if they're lucky, since Raven left. And so COVID has played a great impact on being able to keep our people safe. So looking at that. So if your community is interested in more resources that we have or talking about the grants that you can apply for, you're welcome to reach out to us. Here's my email and our website and our office phone number. Manamase. Does anyone have any questions? So Marilyn did a great job of talking about what some of our services and our shelters look like. And they are very lucky to have a shelter in her area. We know not all of our communities are, and so we focus on building those aspects up and different ways we can help our communities. We have many communities that are using their OVC, the Office of Violent Crimes, to build shelters.
So we have two people raise their hands. Emma Smith, your line is now.
Okay. Yeah, I was just typing my question, but if we were to invite Janelle out to come out here to like put an emphasization on domestic violence or sexual assault, but we need that we need more speakers or presenters. Would you be able to do that, Janelle, with their agency?
Yeah, and we are hoping to come out to you guys, Emma, as soon as we're able to travel again. So we have several different agendas that we focus on when we're looking at our curriculum, and we would it would begin as a community organization. And so we would talk about what your community is looking for, let you pick an agenda and customize that agenda to your area's needs. And as we move through, we would begin to see what other resources we may be able to pull in. So I know, for example, for you and Emma, in Hooper Bay, Emma, you have UPIC Women's, Imonic Women's Shelter, your own shelter staff who are getting trained, and you have, oh, I just lost the name, out of Dillingham, or I'm sorry, out of Bethel.
PWC.
Thank you. And so we would pull together the resources to get the best agenda that's going to work for your community. But the most important thing to realize when we're doing this is that it's your community's training, and we're just there to support you and give you another set of tools to work with.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Emma.
And we have Trina, your line is now open. Or she might have just been raising her hand to answer the "Can you hear me?" Is there any other questions for any of our three presenters today?
Charles, this is Marilyn Castile, and I have one last comment.
Okay.
As you know, I am from Dillingham Bristol Bay Shelter, and if there are any victims out there that live in your community, and they are from Bristol Bay, and they want to come home due to violence, please give our shelter a call. We do have funding to help protect for emergency transportation of people from this area.
Okay. We do have a question that was typed into the chat for the purposes of the webinar. I'm not going to read the name of the actual community, but can any of these groups assist a native village with assistance in starting assessments for domestic violence or sexual assaults?
Yes, we can at Alaska Native Women's Resource Center. That is an intricate part of one of the Office of Victims of Crime grant is doing. We can also do that under the two other grants that we are available under. You do not have to have one of those grants for us to offer services to you.
Okay.
So feel free to reach out if that's the case. Go ahead, Marilyn.
Sorry, Janelle. Safe in Dillingham, we can only assist. We have funding for Bristol Bay Natives and victims who come from here, but probably not anywhere else since we're just the regional shelter here.
And we had a question of can we share the contact information? We will be sharing contact information at the end. If you email Charles Peel, c.peel@3starak.com, we will be sharing a PDF of the presentation as well as the contact information. And the recording will go live on YouTube as soon as we make it 508 compliant. Dreen, I see your hands back up. Would you like to talk? Your mic can be unmuted.
So one thing I want to add while we wait for her to be able to speak is Marilyn mentioned that if there's someone from your community that's from the Dillingham area that is looking to get home, that is in a violent relationship, to reach out to them. I also want to encourage, even if you are not in your community, to reach out to your tribe, because under those OVC grants that we spoke about, many tribes can help a woman, a person leave, not necessarily a woman, but anyone in general leave if they're a victim of crime.
Okay, Trina, you're up.
I just wanted to verify or clarify. Janelle, do you folks get your funding primarily from Department of Justice, or do you have other federal resources?
We have three grantees right now. We have a couple other small, minor grants, but our main grants are the Family Violence Service Prevention Act, the Office Against Violence Against Women, which FIPSA is under Health and Social Services, in the Office Against Violence Against Women grant, in the Victims of Crime grant, or DJJ.
And we will have enough time for one more question. I would like to thank everybody for participating today, especially our presenters. This is definitely not an easy subject to talk about or share personal information about. And this is the contact information for the Alaska Region Training and Technical Assistance staff, that is contractors to the Administration for Native Americans. This year, the murdered, missing Indigenous women became a priority of the Administration for Native Americans, and that is why we brought together the presenters that we did today. And if you have any questions or concerns, please take the time to reach out. If we can't directly answer your question, we know individuals who can. And we are always here to assist in making sure that your questions get answered. We do have other people expressing gratitude in the chat for the presentation today. And with that, I will close today's webinar, and I will be sending a evaluation asking you to comment about how the presentations went. We appreciate your feedback as it helps to guide and shape how we do future presentations. With that, I'm going to stop the recording and conclude today's webinar. Thank you for participating.